Hello, I'm Charlie Brooker, and you're watching Newswipe, a programme all about what's been going on, like this. Nifty blue masks tipped to be the must-have look of the season. Astonishing scenes as supermarket's new Pamplona Taste the Bull range proves too fresh for comfort. And Sky News cheers the nation with an account of an eye-watering escape for a hero.
A British soldier serving in Afghanistan has had a miraculous escape when a bullet passed straight through his helmet.
Yep, that's the way the world goes. But first this.
You know what's boring? Facts are boring. There's no emotion with facts, no soul, just cold, hard data. If facts were a person, they'd be the most tediously conservative little tag nut in the universe. The sort of slappable milquetoast who thinks Coldplay are edgy and finds chicken korma a bit hot.
That's hot.
The news essentially consists of an unending list of boring facts, and that's precisely what it used to look like.
The earliest BBC TV news broadcasts consisted essentially of radio bulletins being read over still images.
The news bosses at the time thought the addition of moving images would distract viewers from the factual content.
Instead, a faceless announcer would talk about the story and then introduce a bit of film at the end of it.
Here is an illustrated summary of the news. It'll be followed by the latest film of events and happenings at home and abroad.
Gradually, a bit more artistry seeped in and visuals became more snazzy, although making them was a pain. Because for years, news graphics had to be laboriously crafted by hand until the 80s, when the Quantel paint box arrived. This allowed the graphics department's imaginations to run riot, even going so far as to put a head on Iran and make it spin around a bit. Wahey! Now, if you think of the raw factual content of the news as an instruction sheet, which you will because that's what I'm telling you to do, then news graphics are supposed to function as the helpful wireframe diagrams that help put the verbal content into context.
Now, that may well have been the case back in ye good old days when the visuals literally were graphs and diagrams.
But now, watching the news is a bit like trying to follow a set of instructions written in a garish font on a belly dancer's undulating torso while a psychopath stands in the room playing the trombone in your ear. Today's CGI visuals punctuate the news like Knowing Terry Gilliam sequences in an old Monty Python episode. Occasionally, they go so overboard, you could be forgiven for thinking you've tuned into a whole new surreal animation series.
Here, she survived by eating dead crabs and hunting wild goats.
Anyway, if you want to see news graphics at their most unhinged, just wait till the next election.
We all know what an election looks like.
Albert Edward Arstall.
Liberal.
4,237.
Oh, you know, we promised when we started doing this series that we'd cut down on all the loser masturbating alone in his flat stuff we used to do in Screen White, but come on, look at this. Oh, God. Oh, I'm going to have to sit on my hands.
8,000.
At heart, elections consist of the dullest facts of all, numbers.
Consequently, news coverage of elections goes absolutely mental in a desperate bid to distract you from how tedious it actually is.
They do this partly by building a stupid great desk for the host to sit behind, showing off like they're in a sci-fi film.
Conservative share of the vote in Torbay, static.
God, this is the most boring Star Trek episode I've ever seen. But they mainly do it with visual trickery.
Visual trickery began with the swingometer, which was neat, simple and easy, which is precisely why it couldn't last. In later years, come election night, Peter Snow was the mad Professor Yaffle of the graphics lab.
His number crunching aside started out relatively sober and clear.
In 1987, he had a thing that looked a bit like the departures board in a train station.
Look at all that blue right the way across.
And in what was a hugely cutting-edge move for the late 80s, some real-time bar graphs, which excitingly could revolve a bit as they ventured upwards.
And that's exactly the way you'd twist one if you were trying to work it up your arse. Not that anyone would want to work one of those up their arse. I don't know why I brought that up, it's just weird. Let's move on.
Yes. Anyway, zip forward to 2001 and Snow's graphics card got upgraded, ending the tyranny of easy-to-understand two-dimensional visuals forever as the swingometer floated off the wall like a haunted clock face.
And it won't this time be a pendulum that moves among the MPs, scything them up and down. It'll be a laser beam, zapping them from blue to red and red to blue.
Reality had entirely sodded off by 2005 as Snow got devoured completely by the Matrix, and the election as a whole became the world's most underwhelming PlayStation 2 game.
Michael Howard coming up now. This is our first forecast. Could change if the light goes on.
Oh, imagine that, having your very own Michael Howard that would just do anything you wanted it to. Oh, I'm going to have to sit on my hands again. Oh. Still, the most excruciating moment ever in election night graphicry didn't belong to Peter Snow. No, that honour went to Jeremy Vine, who took over holodeck duties for the 2008 local elections.
Viewers were treated to a cringe-inducing CGI live-action hybrid starring Vine in a pink shirt tucked into his pants, a virtual Nick Clegg gunslinger thing, oh, and a terrible, terrible, terrible Texan accent. Ugh.
See here, damn, all this here is a shootout saloon.
You know, this is so bad it wouldn't even pass muster on Italian television.
What happens when I shoot this tin can?
The 30,000 viewers die of shame on your behalf.
26%!
By the time the US election rolled round, Vine seemed somewhat chastened and was largely restricted to dealing with actual figures, albeit ones that floated in the air for no f***ing reason whatsoever.
Fortunately for fans of outright idiocy, over-the-top American news network CNN went one better by creating the world's first news hologram.
How is this night for you?
Feels good being here in Chicago. All this technology, I'm being beamed to you like it's Star Wars and stuff.
Yeah, it looks like basically like exactly like in Star Trek when they would beam people down. That's what it looks like right here.
Yeah, it looks just like that episode where they found the unconvincing flickery blue sprite.
Yeah, but yeah.
What's more, graphics aren't just for the hosts to play with these days, thanks to brilliant websites like Sky News Online's Fritzel Interactive. Yes, it's Joseph Fritzel's house, and you can click your way round it. Why? It's so simple, even a child could use it. Anyway, with all this visual fun, no wonder TV and the internet have slaughtered the traditional print media. We'll have more on that later.
It's been a busy old week for the world, but not all of it's been serious. Here's the week in bullshit.
Hullabaloo! As Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad brings gripping controversy to an otherwise dull afternoon on BBC News by introducing a knockabout air of anti-Semitism into a UN conference on race, upsetting Zippo and Coco here in the process.
The end result was startlingly like a jongleur's open mic spot gone horribly wrong.
Guys, did you hear the one about the Jew? Okay, you heard that one. Anyone here from Israel?
Money, get 'em! And the nation's anxious eyes turned to Alistair Darling's face, arms and body as he prepared the most important budget ever.
Sky helped build the anticipation with a series of exciting VTs in which celebrities told us what they'd do if they were Chancellor. I say celebrities, I mean people like Nick Leeson. He was pictured standing up the side of a cliff like a financial cormorant.
Their failure to pay attention has brought Britain to the edge of the financial precipice.
The thrills swelled the next day thanks to Ronnie Wood's estranged wife, Jo Wood, seen here standing in a wood.
In a bid to encourage people to cultivate veg in their window boxes, she said she'd abolish VAT on grow-your-own seeds.
Tomatoes, peppers, aubergines and salads would soon sprout from our flats and houses.
Hang on, did she say tomatoes, peppers, aubergines and salads?
Tomatoes, peppers, aubergines and salads.
Oh, I thought so, yeah. It's my favourite vegetable, that. The salad. The salad vegetable.
The day after Joe's economic revelations, Roger Daltrey rocked up, standing in a hospital.
The lead singer of The Who, standing in a hospital corridor. It's like he's Doctor Who. Doctor Who. I don't know why I bother with you.
He used his slot to plug the Teenage Cancer Trust, which he's a patron of, and that's fair enough, so we're not going to take the piss. Fortunately, the next day's entry required us to be less earnest as former jewellery magnate Gerald Ratner outlined his plans while underwhelmingly superimposed on a cheap fold-out projector screen in a variety of locations for no apparent reason whatsoever while people wandered by ignoring him.
If I was Chancellor...
Never mind if you were Chancellor, you're a magic talking rectangle and no one's paying you any f***ing attention.
Class dismissed.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Chancellor of the Exchequer. The final Alistair Darling wannabe was Neville Staple. Yes, Neville Staple, you know, from the specials. He sang on Ghost Town, and that's why he'd make such a good Chancellor of the Exchequer.
If I was Chancellor, I'd be bloody worried about what's happening today.